Hello students, welcome to the new session of renal physiology, which is acid-base regulation. How much is the normal pH of the body fluid? The normal pH of the body, that is the arterial blood, is 7.4, whereas the venous blood is 7.35. Now this pH should be maintained within a very narrow range, otherwise a lot of metabolic disturbances can occur because of that. First, let's clear some of the concepts. What do you mean by acid? Acid is a chemical substance which can easily donate H plus ion. So H plus ions, it will be, example is the hydrochloric acid, HCl, which will be dissociated into H plus and Cl minus, and this H plus ions can decrease the pH, it can increase the acidity. What is base or alkali, which is commonly called? Now what do you mean by base? One which can easily accept the H plus ion, such as NaOH. NaOH will easily accept the H plus ion and it will be converted into H2O. What will happen if a strong base is added to the body? It will absorb the H plus ion and it can cause alkalosis. It can increase the pH of the body fluid. What is meant by strong acid and a weak acid? An acid in a solution will try to dissociate. Some of them will remain in a combined form, some of them will remain in a dissociate form. Suppose a hydrochloric acid. It will remain in a form of H plus and Cl minus. Now hydrochloric acid is the strong acid. What do you mean by strong acid? Most of it will remain in a dissociated form, that is H plus and Cl minus. Whereas a very little of it will remain in a combined form, HCl. Whereas the carbonic acid or H2CO3 is a weak acid. What do you mean by it is a weak acid? Now most of it will remain in a combined form, H2CO3. Whereas few of it will dissociate into H plus and HCO3 minus. So this is a concept of strong acid and the weak acid. Similarly, the concept of strong base and the weak base, which will remain in a dissociated form and the combined form. Now, what are the sources of acids in our body? Lot of metabolic waste products are acids actually. Sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, bicarbonic acid. The problem, we can divide these acids into two forms. The volatile acids and the non-volatile acids. What do you mean by volatile acids? Ultimately, which can be converted into carbon dioxide and which can be taken care by the respiratory system. You know that carbon dioxide can be easily excreted by the respiratory system. So those acids which can ultimately be converted into carbon dioxide and which can be evaporated, we can say, by the respiratory system, which will be called as volatile acid. But lot of amount of the non-volatile acids are also being produced by the body. Sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, these are the good examples of that. Now these acids should be taken care by kidney only. Kidney can only take care of them. Kidneys can excrete the H plus ion. Kidney can generate the new bicarbonate ion. So non-volatile acids are the one which should be taken care by the kidney, because since they will not be excreted by the lungs. Now whenever these acids are being produced in the body would like to maintain the pH. So the body has got defense mechanisms which can prevent the change in the pH of the blood or the body fluids. Now what are the lines? We can divide this into first line of defense, second line of defense and the third line of defense. First line of defense, which can also be an immediate line of defense, is the buffers in the body. They will act within fraction of seconds. What is a buffer? Buffer is a combination of a weak acid and its salt. So what the buffer will do? A strong acid. They will take up the H plus ion from the strong acid and they will convert it into a weak acid, which will remain in a combined form. As you can see that the H plus ions has not been eliminated from the body by the buffers, but they have just temporarily been converted into a weak acid and they are stored there. Ultimately, this buffers will have to be replenished back, which is done by the second and third line of defense. The second line of defense is the respiratory system. What the respiratory system will do? Respiratory system will evolve out CO2. Most of the volatile acids can be converted ultimately into CO2. So the buffers will ultimately donate the H plus ion into CO2, convert it into CO2, as CO2 can be evolved out. So second line of defense, which will come into action within minutes, is the respiratory system. The rate of ventilation can change and the CO2 that is evolved out, that can change. But when it comes to the excretory system, which is a we can say it as slowly acting, but it is the most permanent solution mainly for the non-volatile acids. What the kidneys can do? Kidneys can do a lot of, I can say, it's a magic. Kidneys can excrete H plus ion, it can absorb all the bicarbonate ion, and if at all it wants, it can synthesize new bicarbonate ion. So kidneys can handle well the situation of acidosis as well as alkalosis, and kidneys play a very important role in regulation of the pH of the body fluid. Now we will start with one by one. Buffer. So what is buffer? Buffer will combine with H plus ion and buffer. Ultimately H plus buffer, which is a combination, which is a weak acid. Mostly it will remain in a combined form. Right? Which are the various buffer systems you know? Bicarbonate buffer system, which is the most important buffer system in the extracellular fluid. Then we have got is the phosphate buffer system, ammonia buffer system. Intracellularly, proteins are synthesized. So these proteins can act as good buffers. Even proteins present hemoglobin, which is a protein present in the RBC, it will also act as a good buffer. So these are the various buffer systems. We will deal it in detail with one by one. Now, as you can see in this slide, a buffer consists of the bicarbonate buffer system. It consists of the H2CO3 and its salts NaHCO3. Now, if you look at this equation, how H2CO3 can be formed? Combination of CO2 and H2, which can be a two-way reaction. H2CO3 again can dissociate into CO2 and H2. So H2CO3 is formed. H2CO3 being an acid again, it will remain in some of it. It will remain in a dissociated form, H plus ion and HCO3 minus ion. But as you can look at these arrows, the bigger arrow is towards the H2CO3. That means more of it will remain in a combined form. And what is a salt? Salt is NaHCO3, which is again a weak acid. It can remain in a dissociated form. That means a Na and HCO3 minus. Now, look at this equation. If I add a strong acid, H plus ion, this H plus ion will tend to combine with the HCO3, and ultimately they will be converted into H2CO3, which is a weak acid. If I add a strong base to this solution, which is NaOH, now if NaOH combines with H2CO3, what will happen? It will be converted into NaCO3 and H2O. NaCO3, which is a weak base, right? So this is how this bicarbonate buffer system will act. Now, for any buffer system, the concept of dissociation constant is very important. What is a dissociation constant? If at all, it is the pH at which the maximally the combined form and the dissociated form, the ratio of the combined form and the dissociated form will be maximum at that pH. That means a buffer, you know, is most active when it is having the highest concentration of the dissociated form and the combined form. So, what is dissociation constant for any buffer system? It is the pH at which the ratio of the dissociated form upon the combined form is maximum. As you can see here, the dissociation constant for the bicarbonate buffer system. What is it is? It is H plus into HCO3 minus, which are the dissociated form, upon H2CO3, which is combined form. Normally in the body, H2CO3 will not remain as H2CO3. It will immediately dissociate into CO2 and H2O. And CO2 can be easily measured. So what is the partial pressure of CO2 multiplied by the 0.03, the solubility of it? So this can give the concentration of H2CO3. So according to this equation, the dissociation constant of the bicarbonate ion buffer system is 6.1. What is, in a simple way, what is the meaning of this? At a pH of 6.1 or around 6.1, this bicarbonate buffer system will be maximally active. But if the pH goes beyond that, then the activity of the bicarbonate system will decrease. Next important concept you should know is Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Now from this equation, if we know the dissociation constant and if we know the bicarbonate ion and the carbon dioxide concentration, we can calculate the pH of the solution. What is the equation for the pH? It is equal to the dissociation constant, that is in this case it's 6.1, plus log of HCO3 upon 0.03 into PCO2. Now if you look at this equation, if I add bicarbonate ion to the solution, what will happen to the pH? the pH will increase. That means it is going to cause alkalosis. What will happen if I add carbon dioxide to the solution? The pH will decrease, that is towards the acidity. Right? So this is the importance of the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Now, bicarbonate buffer system, what is its importance? It becomes a most important extracellular buffer system. Now you can ask me a question here. What is the pH of the extracellular fluid? It is 7.4. What is the dissociation constant of the bicarbonate? It is 6.1. So that 7.4, you are expected that this buffer system will not be that much active. But then why this remains as the most important buffer system in the extracellular fluid? Because if you look at its two factors, that is CO2 and bicarbonate ion, both of this can be managed well at by the two systems. CO2 can be very well handled by the respiratory system, whereas the bicarbonate can be very well handled by the kidney. So since both the ends can be managed well and even by the two different systems, even if one system fails, the other system can remain active. So therefore, this bicarbonate buffer system becomes most important buffer system in the extracellular fluid. Next, we will see about the phosphate buffer system. Now, the phosphate buffer system is important intracellular, and it is also important in the nephrons within the lumen of the tubules. Why this is important intracellularly? Because the phosphate concentration is much more intracellularly. Why it is important in the nephrons? Because whenever the filtrate is being formed and the substances are being reabsorbed, now the phosphate concentration will go on increasing. So therefore, then it becomes an important buffer system in the nephrons. What are the components of the phosphate buffer system? As you can see here, H2PO4 in form of NaH2PO4 and HPO4- in form of Na2HPO4. What will happen if I add a strong acid such as HCl to this solution? HCl will combine with Na2HPO4 and it will form NaH2PO4 and NaCl. What will happen if I combine a strong base such as NaOH to this solution? It will form NaH2PO4, which will form Na2HPO4 and H2. So therefore, this phosphate buffer system can act as a good. What is the dissociation constant or pKa value for the phosphate buffer system? It is 6.8, which can be much more closer to the pH of the urine. So therefore, in the kidneys, it can act as an important buffer system. Other buffers are the proteins. As I have told you, proteins become important buffers inside the cell. A good example of them is the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin can combine with the H+ ions and form HHP, which can act as a good buffer. Now we will see the role of kidney in acid-base balance. Kidneys can reabsorb bicarbonate ions. What all has been filtered? Because lot of amount of bicarbonates have been filtered at the glomerulus. This all needs to be absorbed back. Otherwise, the bicarbonate loss will create acidosis. So therefore, bicarbonate ions should be absorbed. Kidneys can secrete H+ ion, and at the same time, if at all it is required, kidneys can produce new bicarbonate ion. Now, one by one, we will see how this is being done. If you recall my previous lecture, how the bicarbonate ion been absorbed, then in that I have told you that bicarbonates are not easily, it cannot have the transcellular pathway because they are not permeable. So the kidneys will do the indirect absorption of bicarbonate ion. How it is being done? Let's see that this is the tubular cell. This is the lumen of the nephron and this is the interstitium. So what will happen in the cell? The CO2 will combine with H2O and with the help of the enzyme carbonic anhydrase, H2CO3 will be formed. H2CO3 will dissociate into bicarbonate ion and the H+ ion. Bicarbonate ion will be absorbed and the H+ ion will be secreted. This H+ ion can combine with NaCO3 present in the filtrate and ultimately it will form Na+ and the H2CO3. H2CO3 will dissociate again into CO2 and H2O. This CO2 can easily diffuse inside the cell and again form the new bicarbonate ion. So what has happened? One bicarbonate ion from the filtrate has been converted to CO2 and this again its CO2 is utilized to form new bicarbonate ion which is being absorbed. So this is the indirect way by which the bicarbonate ion from the filtrate has been absorbed by the interstitium. Whenever this H plus ion is secreted. As we have seen there, what is this the function of this H plus ion? It should be titrated. It should be balanced. It should be mixed with the SCO3 ion so that all the SCO3 ions can be absorbed. Right? But what will happen if the all bicarbonate ions in the filtrate, they have been absorbed back? Excess of H plus will now create acid, or it will decrease the pH of the urine. Normally the maximum or the minimum pH at which the urine should be excreted can be 4.5. So if the H plus ion, about 80 milli equivalent of the volatile, non-volatile acids, they are being synthesized in the body. So if the kidney wants to excrete so much amount of the H plus ion, then the urine will become much more acidic. So any excess of H plus ions, after they have been titrated with the bicarbonate ion, they should be buffered. Now here comes the roles of the buffers present in the lumen or the tubule, which will cause buffering of this H plus ion so that the pH of the urine should not decrease much. What are the buffers present in this? The most important buffer present in the lumen is the ammonia buffer system. Now what the ammonia buffer system consists of? It is consisting of the glutamine. Glutamine, which can be converted into 2SCO3 and a ammonium ion. Now as you can see in this is the renal tubular cell, this is the lumen, and this is the interstitium. Whenever the body wants to excrete excess of H plus ion, the glutamine synthesis by the cells will increase. And this glutamine, by number of reactions, it can be converted into 2 bicarbonate ion and the ammonium ion. This ammonium ion can easily diffuse into the lumen, and along with the chloride, it will excrete it out. Now, as you can see in this buffer system, if at all with the glutamine, if the buffer is being formed, at the same time, 2 bicarbonate ion being generated. So, buffering of H plus ion in the renal tubule will generate new bicarbonate ion. Remember this rule. Another important buffer system is the phosphate buffer system, as I have told you previously. That will also act as an important buffer system in the renal tubular cell. Now, how to know about how much acid has been excreted by the urine? For that, we will do the titratable acidity of the urine. That means if you look at this equation, net acid excreted is equal to the ammonium excretion, because that is the buffer which is most active, plus urinary titratable acid. Now what do you mean by urinary titratable acid? The amount of strong base, it has to be added to the urine so that the pH of the urine become equal to that of the extracellular fluid, that is 7.4, minus bicarbonate ion excreted. So this is how we can calculate the net acid which is excreted by the kidney. Now coming to some of the applied aspects related to the acid-base balance, and which are clinically also and exam point of view also are much more important, because these are the ones which are commonly faced. Concept of acidosis and alkalosis. If the pH of the extracellular fluid becomes less than 7.4, it will be called as acidosis. If it becomes more than 7.4, that will be called as alkalosis. There are two conditions: metabolic acidosis and alkalosis, and respiratory acidosis and alkalosis. Now, what do you mean by metabolic acidosis and alkalosis? Here, most of them, the result is because of the kidney failure or the primary disturbances in the bicarbonate ion secretion, synthesis or absorption. Whereas respiratory acidosis or alkalosis mainly result because of the disturbances in the excretion of the CO2, that means due to some respiratory diseases. We will see in detail one by one. What are the causes of respiratory acidosis? As I told you, it is because of the abnormality in the ventilation. So if the CO2 excretion is depleted, CO2 will get more accumulated and that will generate acidosis. So what are the conditions in which the CO2 can be, the ventilation can be depressed? It can happen decreased ventilation. It can even happen because of the damage to the respiratory centers. Or even if the ventilation is normal, but the perfusion at the alveolar capillary membrane, that is less, which can happen in some disease conditions such as pneumonia, or it can happen in emphysema. So in that case, if there is obstruction to the respiratory passage and the ventilation is ultimately affected, that can even cause acidosis. So these are the examples of the respiratory acidosis in conditions in which it can occur. What are the conditions in which respiratory alkalosis can occur? When excess of CO2 is excreted, the ventilation is more than normal. When this can happen? A good physiological example of it, when a person goes to the high altitude. When the person goes to the high altitude, decreased oxygen level in the surrounding atmosphere will ultimately stimulate the respiration and the hyperventilation will start to absorb more and more of the oxygen. But because of the hyperventilation, the CO2 will be excreted more. So this can create alkalosis. This can happen in some of the psychoneurotic cases also. Excess ventilation or ventilation is more and it can create the respiratory alkalosis. Metabolic acidosis, which are much more common thing related to most of them related to the kidney diseases, are some examples of them, such as in the acute or chronic renal failure that will cause metabolic acidosis. In Addison's disease, deficiency of the aldosterone that is going to cause Fanconi syndrome, where there is a defect in the absorption in the renal tubular system. Diarrhea. In diarrhea, lot of fluid rich in the bicarbonate that is being lost. So because of that, there is going to be a metabolic acidosis. Diabetes mellitus, diabetic ketoacidotic state. So that can create a metabolic acidosis. Excess ingestion of the acetyl salicylic, that is aspirin, that can even create the metabolic acidosis. What are the examples of the, or what are the conditions in which the metabolic alkalosis can happen? Diuretics. Now, how the diuretics can create excess use of diuretics, I can say. How the diuretics can create alkalosis? Because of the when the diuretic is given to the patient, the flow in the renal tubular cell that will increase. More amount of sodium, because less sodium will be absorbed if the flow is much rapid. By the less sodium will be absorbed with the PCT and more sodium will reach to the distal tubule. So if more sodium reaches to the distal tubule, it is trying to absorb sodium and in response to that, it will counter transport H plus ion along with that. So H plus ions, more amount of H plus ions will be secreted by the distal tubule. Ultimately, it is going to result in alkalosis. Excess of aldosterone, any tumor of the adrenal cortex, vomiting of the gastric contents, HCl is vomited out, so that remains a common cause of the alkalosis, and some of the alkaline drugs that can be given for the treatment of acidity or gastric ulcer, that such as sodium bicarbonate, that can even cause the alkalosis. To diagnose, how to diagnose, what is the exact cause of, what is the condition and what is the cause of that condition, which type of the acidosis or alkalosis it is, we have to evaluate certain parameters. First, you should know what is the normal pH, 7.4. How much is the normal bicarbonate ion concentration, 24 milliequivalent per liter. And how much is the partial pressure of CO2, 40 mmHg. Now, if you know this value, and then if you calculate this value in a person, let's say if in respiratory acidosis, what should be the found? Acidosis means what should happen to the pH? pH should be less. It is a respiratory acidosis. So ultimately, what should happen to the CO2 level? CO2 level will be increased. And now, if there is a respiratory acidosis, the body has the kidney only to compensate for that. So what the body will do? Kidneys will conserve more and more of the bicarbonate ion. So as a compensatory mechanism, there will be increase in the bicarbonate ion in the body fluid. So in respiratory acidosis, what is the picture you find? Decrease in pH, increase in POCO2, and compensatory increase in the bicarbonate ion condition. What do you find in the respiratory alkalosis? Alkalosis means pH will increase, CO2 will decrease, and compensatory decrease in the bicarbonate ion. What will find in the metabolic acidosis? Decrease in pH, decrease in bicarbonate, and compensatory decrease in the PCO2. What do you find in the metabolic alkalosis? Increase in pH, the primary disturbances is because of the bicarbonate ion. So therefore the bicarbonate ion will increase, but respiratory system will try to compensate and it will increase the PCO2 level. Treatment, most important, you should treat the cause as such. But up till you treat the cause, there are some neutralizing drugs that can be given In acidosis, sodium bicarbonate can be used either orally or intravenously, and in alkalosis, ammonium chloride can be used orally. It is well tolerated there, right? So with this, we come to the end of this lecture, acid-base regulation. Thank you.